So special. Everywhere in the Doxero family, kids are ministering this morning and giving people an impression of the Holy Spirit. Isn't that incredible? Now imagine that happening in the different schools and families where that happens, and we see God move in a powerful way. Right, so guys, I hope that you're ready to hear the word of God. And I'm saying that carefully because people have asked me, don't you find it very scary to say, thus saith the Lord? I say, yeah, it's not scary. Luckily, it's what the Bible teaches us about Him and the Holy Spirit speak to us. But it's your responsibility to ask God, what is it that you are meant to hear this morning? Okay? So I humbly submit to you the conversation on Our Father, on prayer, as Jesus taught us, and going into a little bit of the purpose when we pray Our Father. If you've been here last week and the week before, conversation was started by Taiki, and then Manalisi shared last week and today. Did they mention it's his birthday today? Guys, if you don't know, it's his birthday today. That guy, okay? Yeah. Yeah, he's 19 or 20. I can't remember the age. He doesn't even hear it. Okay, Mana, happy birthday from us all, ne? Okay, here's it. Oh, it's you, buddy. All right. But today we're going to have the conversation with something of what the heart of Jesus is behind why teaching this to his disciples. And the whole thing about prayer is one of those conversations. If you've been a Christian a long time, you go, what's there to say? You know, no pun in that, when you pray. But there is something incredible about praying to the living God. It's a different kind of thing than just having a conversation between two people, because you can't see that God. So if you pray somewhere and there's nobody who's Christian, they'll think you awkward and weird. Who are you talking to, buddy? You know, what? Who is this person? I don't see anybody. So unless they know there's a living God, it will be strange. But still, it feels very natural to pray. There's something absolutely mystical about it when you're praying to not just an unseen God, but an all-powerful God who knows all things and can listen to everybody at the same time. I don't know how that works. When my kids sit around the table and they get excited, they all speak at the same time. I go, guys, whoa, you, then you. You now speak. I can only handle one at a time. Eh? If you're a teacher, I taught for 3 years, same thing. Hands up, one at a time. But God listens to everybody, and I'm so glad He does. Because if I'm starting to pray, and God is saying, 1 second, Rian is still busy. You know, let me just finish. She prays long, man. Wait. Okay, now you. Oh, no, sorry, she started to pray. Now, I'm glad that's not the God we have. Can you imagine, take a number, how long that number would be? All the Christians are praying, you know, number 2,100 million, whatever. Listen carefully, and 200 million, whatever. It could be an incredible, difficult thing if God was like that, but He's not. He can listen to us all pray at the same time, know exactly what you're thinking before you're saying it, and that just blows my mind. There was this game ranger who had to take all these international guests, showing them animals they've never seen before. And he grew up in the Free State somewhere. He didn't speak anything else but Afrikaans. So it was very hard for him to understand what all these Germans and Americans and English, all of them together, and they see an impala and they want to ask questions, and every buffalo and everything, and everybody asked questions at the same time. And at one moment, they were all asking at the same time the same questions. And he said, stop talking. Only once upon a time. You know? So that didn't go that well for him, but I'm glad that God is not saying that to us. He can listen to us all at the same time. And here, Jesus had his disciples. 2,000 years ago, they understood something about God by seeing Jesus. Remember, they said, Jesus, just show us the Father, and that will be enough. And he said, hey, you see me, you see him. And they went like, okay, so you are God incarnated. Jesus, that's incredible. We speak to you. But Jesus went to go and pray early in the mornings. Now his disciples want to follow him and everything he does. And of all the things they see Jesus do, all the miracles, all the incredible sermons, they didn't ask for his sermon notes. They didn't ask for the trick to make water into wine. I would have asked that. That's just incredible. Jesus, can you just show me again? What did you do? You know, and is it more like a Shiraz or a Pinotage? I mean, that will be a great trick. No, they said, no, how do you speak to your Father? How do you pray? How do you speak to this incredible Creator God? all over the place and in us. And it's like, wow, how do you speak to him? I've been wondering as a small child, what would I say if I ever meet the president? You know, do you stand, tend, do you, I don't know, do you greet, do you hug? Or you, what do you do? I don't know. What's the protocol when you meet the queen? Big people, there's a certain way to talk, and the disciples wanted to know. Another little story that's just funny was this little altar boy who worked in this convent place or monastery, and the cardinal came to visit them, and there this little boy is, and he had an important job to wake the cardinal on the Monday morning when he starts his daily activities at their place. So he's not from there. The cardinal comes and visits from wherever headquarters, and now this little altar boy had the job to wake him up. It was before phones and stuff and alarms. He was the alarm. And months before that Monday morning, he was picked, said, "You will wake the cardinal with protocol." Okay, what? Said, "This is what you do. You knock three times at the door where he's going to sleep, his room. And then you say, 'Good morning, my lord. It's the boy. It's time to get up.'" And he wrote it down and he studied it and he looked at the Greek and the Hebrew and the Aramaic of all of it, and he knew those phrases. "Good morning, my lord. It's the boy. It's time to get up." Okay. And they took him through the protocol, three times knocking. He will say, "Yes." And then you say, "Good morning, my lord. It's the boy. It's time to get up." So he nailed it. He could say it frontwards, backwards. No. So that weekend came, the nerves, the adrenaline. It's the moment of his life. Sunday evening, didn't sleep much because of the tension. Monday morning, 5 o'clock. He had to wake him at 6. 5 o'clock, he was standing in front of the door, counting down the seconds. Now, he's not going to mess this up. I mean, he's got this. And but tension built, because he knows, you know, if he gets it wrong, trouble. And 6 o'clock on the dot, he knocks. But now tension high, adrenaline full 100% in his blood. Now, so he knocks. And then from the other side, didn't come a yes, but, "Yes, who is it? What do you want?" And the moment was just too big. And he said, "Good morning, my boy. It's the Lord. Your time's up." So that didn't come out as right as he wanted. But something funny about it is sometimes my prayers feel like that. What do I say to God? Do I just start speaking? Do I have to address him in a specific way? How do I speak to somebody who's much bigger than this cardinal? And the disciples wanted to know. But wonderful for the fact that people wrote it down. And one of the disciples, Matthew, wrote it for us. And we're going to read it out loud together. Maybe you prayed it as a young person many, many times. And it's so well known to your brain, you can read it without thinking. But let's just read it. This is Jesus' answer to his disciples with the question, how do we pray? Okay, you ready? Nice and loud. It's the second service. There's more heat. You can do it. Okay, guys, here we go. Our Father in heaven, your name be honored as holy. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. 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 Now here, Jesus teaches us directly what he knows from his Father. Okay? So I've got 3 kids. So when my kids bring friends home, I don't know if they ever ask them, how do I address your parents? To go, Mr. and Mrs. De Jager, or hello, oom, hello, Tani, or hi, sir. I don't know if they, but they wouldn't have to ask unless they don't know. And my kids would say, "Yo, my dad is a kind of friendly guy. You just, you know, he will probably give you a side hug and give you a fist bump. And that's how you talk to him." And they need to believe them because they speak to me every day. So Jesus, who speaks to his Father all the time, is the one teaching. So the weight of this prayer is not a little thing that you download on some kind of website. This is Jesus saying, "I know my dad. You want to know how to talk to him? Let me tell you." Okay? And now here he starts and he says, "Our Father." Hey, if you've heard 10 sermons about it, it's 900 too few on the power of what it means to go, "Our Father," because they've seen him pray. Your Father. And now he starts with our Father and includes them all. And I wonder if they just went, what? Did he say our Father? Did he not say my father, our father? And one of the disciples went like, what? We all belong to him. What a good way to start. Immediately what it settles is family. We've got a father. Of all the things God is. Now, if Jesus prayed this prayer and he started it this way, O Creator, Almighty God of heaven and earth that made everything that's all powerful that nobody can understand fully, I would go, yeah, that's a good start, man. That's real, you know. Oh, and thank you for being my father as well. Just throw it in there, you know. It's like if your dad was president, how would you greet him? If it's your dad, you go, good day, sir. You know, thank you for allowing me in your presence. Or run up and hug him and say, hey, dad, you're cool. You're the president, you know. And maybe your friends going with you will not greet in the same way unless you say, he's a cool guy. You can greet him as well, but he's also the president, which is fantastic. And it's like Jesus wants to say, if God was this faraway one to you, now you start the conversation with the king, the ruler of the world who created everything, with Father. Incredible. Your prayer, my prayer can start like that. It should be because Jesus says it. We are created as beings who's got his life in us. That's why it makes sense. When Adam was created, God breathed into him that ruach breath. He came alive with God's life. So when you and I speak to him, there's something that happens. It just makes sense. I find it fascinating when I would sit with somebody that says, I'm in the deepest trouble I've ever been in. Okay, what's wrong with you? I've got no money, no job, no place to stay. What do you want? Prayer. Why? Because when we pray, that sense of peace, being aware of our Father, is much greater than your sense of, I need, I want, I'm in trouble, I'm desperate. Sometimes I say, like, you don't have to pray, you just need money. I say, no. We can talk about it, but pray. Our Father just brings... And that sense of tranquility in a way, in the midst of what you're going through. I don't know how it works, but it's because the life in us connects with the life giver that we know. That's how Jesus starts his conversation. I see it in many ways displayed. My son, Marcus, he went on a school trip last year, and high school trips, boys together playing tennis, not everything there is as holy as it should be. Yeah, the jokes and this conversation and the stuff they want to explore, it's that time of their life. Now he goes in there, young boy, youngest in the team, and he has to sit with those guys after hours and be part of the conversations. And that Saturday night, he calls me and he's upset. And it's late. It's long past his bedtime because nobody's in bed yet. And he calls me and he says, Dad, I'm really upset with what's happening here. These guys are talking about stuff, making jokes. It's not, you know, for me, knowing God. And I mean, he didn't have to say that. He was just so upset with what's happening around him. Now, I wish I could just drive there. It was somewhere in the Western Cape. I couldn't. I couldn't rescue him from that situation. But what did I do as his dad? He spoke. Okay, but so what are you going to do? You know that's not you, né? No, I know that. You know that God has given you strength, yes? So I just reminded him of truth. And he was already at a better place. And I said, let's pray. And we prayed over the phone together. How do you feel now? I feel great. End of the next day, they came back the Monday. How do you feel? He said, a fantastic day. Nothing changed in his circumstances. Nothing. But something of what's inside of him connected with me as the earthly dad. Nothing godly in the way that God is. Just a safe space for him. But now talking to God. And we could together pray, our Father. You're a great God. You know where my son is and you know stuff on him. Will you strengthen him? And internally, things started changing and he could deal with the outside world where nothing has changed, but he has. Prayer does that every time. And it starts with our Father. Your name is holy. You're incredible. And you're my Father. So when Jesus introduces that, no distance. No distance. No far God. No in heaven over there, and I hope that he can listen to me and not take a number of everybody praying. No. I find that incredible. And when Jesus then prayed these words, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. It's so profound, and please don't allow your brain to go, I've heard that so many times, I know what you're going to say. To me, who met God when I was 6 years old, so it's 41 years that I've been knowing Jesus, and it's like this part of Jesus' prayer is getting more meaning for me every year exponentially as I dive into it. Because here Jesus establishes a few things. And maybe there's something you can teach me about it as well. But Jesus spoke about kingdom. Kingdom is the king's domain, the rulership of the king. And Jesus said, let your kingdom come, meaning let the rulership of God become my reality. What happens when you're under the protection of a king? There's protection, there's covering, there's guidance. There is a legitimacy of belonging. And for people who ran around who wanted earthly kingdom as a reality, Jesus had to change the mindset in the prayer. What did the disciples want? Israel, its own king, Romans die. Ne? Oppressors out, we want to be established again. They had an earthly sense of when we are in charge. Jesus prayed a prayer saying, when you are not in charge, when God's domain becomes your reality. I don't think they realized it then. I think your kingdom, maybe that's one of us becoming king with you, Jesus is the ruler or whatever. And Jesus had to come and change the mindset. And he spoke about it a lot. In Matthew 4 verse 17, we read where Jesus preached and he said, repent of your sin, turn to God, for the kingdom of heaven is near. He said, stop thinking your own way. Get rid of the sin in your life. The rulership of Jesus is near. In Luke 7, he says, the kingdom is in your midst or among you or within you. It's not something that you go, oh, it's over there. You know, you can go to the United Kingdom or maybe to the Zulu Kingdom, or I've been in Norway, the King's Castle. You can walk up to the front door and knock, and you know, there are kingdoms that you can engage and disengage with. Here he says, it's in you if the rulership of God becomes real to you, if you surrender to that. And you have to pray the prayer, okay, your rulership over me, and really get that established in your life. And then he says these words, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. What does it mean? God, your plan for me. Your plan for me. What you want for me. Your will in heaven, meaning God has a plan. Otherwise he prayed, God, let my plans work out as best as they can. And let me not mess it up too much. But here he says, may your will be done on earth as it is determined in heaven. God has a plan. You are part of it. The whole Bible confirms it. God didn't make any mistakes. Everybody has some kind of ideal. And not saying that you have to buy this toothbrush to comb your hair at 7 o'clock in the morning. It just means your purpose of knowing God for who he is and living the best you in serving him. That's the will for everybody. And how you do it, God deals with everybody separately. But there is a plan and you submit to that by saying, may your will be done. Even in Proverbs 16 verse 1, it's written, we can make our own plans, but the Lord gives the right answer. Doesn't mean don't have any plans. It means you live your life, but there is an answer, the right way of doing it that God knows. And Jesus brings that conversation from the Old Testament that these guys knew. And he says, now you pray that prayer. Now you actively consider the implication of what it is. Why? Because we've got a good Father and he knows best. And you have to either believe it or doubt it and not trust him at all. And that's a little tough. Because this statement is sometimes stealing an hour of sleep at night to me. It says he's either Lord of all or not Lord at all. Have you heard it before? He's either Lord of everything of your life or you can't trust him. Because why would you give a certain part of your life to him and then withhold the rest? What does it say about your trust in the first place? Now, that's a little tough to me. Because there are times when I would say, God, I give you my future as long as it includes these things. Yeah. So then I'm praying, Lord, do you hear my plan, a great plan? Could you maybe just make sure it happens like next month? You know? And when it doesn't happen like that, I'm upset. And then I start doing my own thing. Okay, God, maybe you don't want to do it. You're a little late. Let me on my own way. Never works out. Always leads to strife, disappointment. And I realize if he's not Lord of all, how can he be Lord at all? If I think about my marriage, if I think about my kids, if I think about my income, there has to be a place where this prayer makes sense, in your spirit at least, even if it doesn't make sense in what you see. I think this is one of the trickiest parts of prayer. Because you can easily say the words, but do you trust God? Because oftentimes, it feels like God isn't seeing the plan that I have, and I need to convince Him. For your business, God, if I can just have this contract in place and this promotion by then, and then it doesn't happen, and He's like, God, can't you see? Why are you late on my plan? Why are you not doing what's obviously best for me? And the moment you want to remove the lordship of God in that space, then you're in trouble. And then we find ourselves at the end of that season going, I had to surrender when it all went to shambles. And I'm thinking, why do you have to wait until it breaks down completely that you give it to God and not pray this prayer before you enter into that space? Jesus says in John 4, He says, it's His will, it's His food to do the will of God. It's crazy. He says, what I eat and drink is the will of God. What He wants for me is not something I check in, like on a list, am I still on par? He says, it's my nutrition to my day. This prayer is so important that whatever feeds His thinking and His doing is, God, what You want for me. God, this place that I'm in, my studies, what You want for me. This person that I'm working with, this family member that feels like they want to, you know, break me apart. What is it that You want for me in this space? Not my own response to this. It's like a daily prayer, but it liberates you. For many, this is a hard prayer. For me, it was sometimes very tough. And I realized if my understanding of who God is not strong, it leads to the wrong kind of prayer. If my kids would come to me in the morning and I say, hey, did you sleep well? How are you? Morning, Dad, I need money for school. I need new shoes. Thank you. Have a nice day. See you next week. No, oh, good chat. No, that was lekker. No. Or what the hell is wrong with you? I just want to ask you how you are. Can we just have a chat and drink coffee? No, but I also need my bicycle to be fixed. But why is it not done yet? That would not be a good reference of a conversation. If they know me and how I love playing games, playing ping pong, going for walks, card games, chatting about life, they would probably enjoy that. And in the conversation, I will hear what they need. They will know what's important to me. They will realize after a while, yo, I can hear that what I think is important is not that critical to Him. And He knows best because He's got a bit more experience. So maybe I should just let that be. But if you don't know who God is, your prayers will be frustrating you and God. If my kids come to me and ask stuff all the time and never want to talk, do you think I will go, oh, how cute, you know, look at the photo. I say, no, no, guys, you don't know me and you don't know what you need. So this is not a good conversation. So I'll probably not answer those requests if it's not good for them. But we sometimes pray. James speaks of it in the Bible. James 4 verse 2 and 3. It says, you don't have things because what you want because you don't pray for them. And when you pray for things, you don't get them because you want them for the wrong reason, for your own pleasure. It's like saying, guys, whoa, whoa, whoa. You don't pray. And when you pray, you want stuff. You don't know this God that you're speaking to. You think because of whatever background, He's the guy that just hands out blessings to you, and you're not that nice. No, you're going to not have a job. You're going to have no house for you, but two for you, five for you. And He hands out these things, and we just feel He's an unfair God, and we just plead that He will make us as blessed as Marina says, because man, what a nice guy He is. So if you don't know Him, praise will feel like it doesn't work. But if you know His heart, and that He wants conversation, then prayer becomes something incredibly significant. God is after that conversation. It builds relationship, and He likes that. Does He want us to flourish and have what we need? Of course. But it can never make sense without relationship. Then the things become what we want and not Him. And you'll never have enough. Eh? You see people, and it breaks your heart, that has stuff, that tries to supplement for their relationship with God, and the trap of that, it never gets enough. Why is it that some of the most richest people who don't know God feel like they never have enough, they have to reach more, because that's the trick. The devil goes, there's something more that you can achieve. You don't have as much as that guy. And it's this ever recurring cycle of wanting stuff that you can never get without praying, our Father, my Father. I say, Lord, I don't want to be in that trap. You spend enough time with somebody, you become like them. My kids came from a double medium English school, so their English was good. They spoke English a lot. Now, two of them in high school, and they speak a different kind of English. They've got such a weird accent now. They say, what happened to you guys? Said that we can't help it. That's how everybody sounds. So you become who you spend time with. And you know, if you have kids and when you were young, you were warned, don't spend time with that guy because what he does, if you start doing, you know, and she is a bad influence on you, so don't spend time. So the opposite is also true. Spend time with the right people and it will influence how you think and talk. My dad used to say, ask me questions that I can say yes for. It's like, what do you mean, Dad? That's like, that's weird, you know. But he actually invited us as kids. We were five kids. He said, know me enough that you'll ask me things that you know I want for you because it's good for you. Don't ask me for a very sharp knife when you're 3 years old. I'll say no. You're going to cry and think I'm unfair. It's good for you to not have a knife at three. But if I know my dad, if I spend time with him, I start realizing what it is that he wants for me. It's easier to surrender to somebody you know has got your best at heart. How would you know they've got the best for you at heart? Spend time in prayer. Oftentimes, I have to choose again to surrender. Surrender who I am, what I think, what I do. And I wish I would get to that place where I can just say, listen, and Paul sometimes says, follow me as I follow Christ. I wish I could be at that place to say, listen, you just go through every dark season like I do. It's just hallelujah through it. You know, I don't even feel it. I see the calamity and I just unemotionally, no, it's not like that. And it's sometimes tough because I had to pray this prayer recently. Ask God, you know, how do I surrender this part and trusting your will because I don't see it the way I want it. And my kids sometimes give me a little grief. They say, Dad, you preach about these things. Have you got it down? So I don't know. How well do you have it down before you can talk about it? Maybe we should just be on a journey together where we inspire one another on this journey because there are times when you will probably have to be reminded. Saying, hey, is it a little tough? Yeah. Are you holding on to your plans or where are you with that conversation? I don't know. Maybe, can I pray with you? Can we bring it to God? Maybe good. And there are times when people look at me and saying, I can see that I need to pray with you on that as well. There was this humbling moment, not humbling to Jesus, but to me in reading about him, where if you know what Jesus went through in his life story, where he prayed this prayer. He didn't just teach the disciples how to pray it. He prayed it himself. And the night when Jesus was arrested and then crucified, he knew what was happening. He told his disciples, guys, I'm going to be arrested and I'm going to die. And now the night that it happens, he goes and he prays in the Garden of Gethsemane. It's a very well-known moment that Jesus had. And he prays a very tough prayer that I would never have expected Jesus to feel. He knows his Father well. He is part of the triune expression of God. But as part of his full human expression, he prayed this prayer. He went into the garden with his disciples and a few hours before he was arrested. And he said to his disciples, my soul is crushed with grief to the point of death. Do we have it up there? It's not them. Okay. So he speaks to them and he says, my soul is so broken, I want to die. I'm thinking, God, I don't know how many times I've been there. Maybe not. But can you imagine Jesus saying, my soul is crushed with grief to the point of death. And he asked his disciples, stay here and keep watch with me. He went on a little farther and bowed with his face to the ground, praying, my Father, can you see his prayer? Starts with Father. He could have started, oh, all-powerful one that can do anything. No, my Father. If it is possible, let this cup of suffering be taken away from me. What does that prayer sound like today? My Father, if I don't have to go through this dark season of my life, please. My Father, if I don't have to struggle with this depression, please. Father, if I don't have to suffer every month by thinking how I'm going to pay just to stay alive, oh, please. And I think, okay, now what do you pray after that? Then Jesus prays what he taught his disciples. But he says, yet I want your will to be done, not mine. At times I felt guilty if I come before God and I'm saying I'm really at a tough place because I should know better. I mean, I've been a Christian so many years. And there are times when it feels, you know, the situation is not getting me under. There are times when it feels it's tricking or tripping me up and on the floor. And I have to pray like Jesus. Lord, I don't want to go through this. It's not what I want. But not my will, but your will be done. So whatever you want to do, God, in this moment, I'll surrender to that. It's not my preference. It's not my choice. And as long as that moment is not as a result of your own sin that you're causing it. Sometimes we do stupid stuff and we're saying, God, I'm suffering and I want out of this and your will be done. Then you're saying, Lord, I messed up and God's grace covers you. And then he turns it around and you say, Lord, even if I messed it up, not my will be done, but your will be done. And you take me where you want me to go, where I can't control it, you can. And then like Jesus, you just surrender whatever you're in. And what happened to him is why you and I can sit here. The fact that he prayed that prayer meant that he went through that suffering for the greater good of all mankind. And I'm thinking, have I prayed myself out of situations that maybe there was something greater for people around me that I want to get out of? Because I can't see it, and therefore no one do it. I'm saying, Lord, forgive me for the amount of times when I said, I don't want to go through a hard season. I don't want any tension in my life. I want my will to be done, Lord, and you must make it happen. And maybe God is saying, if you only knew what I want to reach through what you're going through, just let it go. So I don't know where you're at with this. If it's hard for you to pray that prayer, the Holy Spirit helps you. Romans 8, Paul writes, he said, if those moments when you can't go beyond the prayer, Our Father, and you don't know what to say, the Holy Spirit beautifully helps you sometimes to say, don't say anything. You say, Our Father, and you enjoy having a Father. That's it. And there are times when you just start speaking to God. And if you don't know what to say, you pray the Lord's Prayer. And maybe the Holy Spirit will stir in you more things that you can say. But in that moment, you surrender. You're saying, God, okay, these things in my life going great. Your will be done. These things I'm struggling with, I don't know. Your will be done. Lord, these things, I'm going to make plans, like in Proverbs. I don't know if it's going to work out, but your will be done. And you pray that it becomes the source of your nourishment every day. That you feel, Lord, help me to never step into a space out of my own wisdom, but always allow the Holy Spirit to lead you. In a moment, we're going to pray, but I want to ask that we respond just to allow something of that to go and grab the right place of your heart. Yeah? And we're going to sing the song, sing the prayer. And maybe in that moment, allow the Holy Spirit to come and stir within us. Jesus, what did you mean? What's the power of that for me this morning? And what's the appointment you had with me to hear this? And where am I holding on to my own thing still? And I know the Holy Spirit is saying, let go of that. Let go of that and just say, Lord, I don't know what your plan is yet, but I will follow you. And I pray that your kingdom will come in my life. Because when you rule and reign over me, there's safety, there's protection, there's joy. Okay? So let's stand. And as Mona Lisa is leading us, we sing the song, asking the Holy Spirit to speak to us. And I will, after that, just have a moment of prayer where we pray together. Okay? Let's stand and we sing it together.